Good evening. My name is Ted Koppel. I believe you know my friend Elie Wiesel. I'd like you, for a moment, to imagine a long beach stretching in front of you. It's a beautiful morning. Not too long after sunrise, the sun is sparkling on the waves, which are kind of choppy, and the beach is deserted, except for two figures walking along the edge of the water. As they come closer, you recognize that one of them is an older woman, and the other one is a small child. Maybe 2 or 3 years old. The woman is holding the child by the hand, but at one point, the little boy slips away and runs about 20 yards down the beach. And then he steps into the water and is picked up by an errant wave and swept out to sea. The old woman looks around desperately for help. She is frantic. She doesn't know what to do. She doesn't know where to turn. The little boy is now about 150 yards out at sea. And finally, in desperation, she looks up toward heaven. And she pleads with the Almighty. God, she says, you know how desperately I love that little boy. Don't let anything happen to him. I beg you, please return him safely to me. And as miraculously as the little boy was swept out to sea, another wave picks him up, carries him gently in, and drops him, giggling with laughter, at his grandmother's feet. She is trembling with emotion. She kisses the little boy 20 times on his head. And then she looks up toward heaven and she says, he had a hat. I like that joke, Elie, because it summarizes so much of our relationship with the Almighty, doesn't it? When we are in desperate need, we turn to God. And when things are going along all right, we become a little more demanding. I like that joke because it contains within it a lot of things that you and I can talk about. First of all, prayers of petition. How do you feel about prayers of petition? How do you feel about praying to God for a particular result?
First of all, I think I ought to explain to you why we are here. Usually I'm alone. But I felt for 60 odd years that I have been here, something was missing occasionally. And I asked my friend Ted to come and help me fill it with words. We have been friends for many, many years.
Elie, let me just do something. I think that microphone is a little bit too close.
Now you know who knows anything about microphones. Not me. Is it good? I don't know.
I think it's fine.
Can you hear me?
Yes. Okay.
So when we decided to have these conversations, because really I've been here for more than 60 years, and I felt, what can I do better? Is to invite my friend and have a conversation. It should, can you hear me? I was afraid of that.
Yeah. It was working fine till I messed with it, wasn't it?
How about now? Can you hear me now? Perfect. So, this is not really, this is not an interview. It's a conversation between two friends. Believe me, it's totally unrehearsed. So we don't know what we are going to say to each other. But we do, because we have known each other for so many years. So I know more or less, really, where Ted comes from, his passion, and also his memories. And now, when on the telephone we spoke about what are we going to talk about, I wanted to say about everything, naturally. But then we said God. I like that. After all, I'm sure that for the 60-odd years that I have been here, I spoke a lot about God. Why? Because I spoke about the Bible, I spoke about the Talmud, I spoke about Hasidism, I spoke about mysticism. But each time, it's God. Where is God? There was a marvelous story. A Hasidic master asked his child, he said, "Can you tell me, if you tell me where God is, I will give you a coin." And the child said, "Dad, if you tell me where God is not, I'll give you two coins." God is God, which means God is. If you believe in God, if you don't, then of course the conversation has a different meaning.
Eli, I'm not going to let you get away that easily. You have endured so much during the course of your lifetime that the question of whether you believe in prayers of petition is not a trivial question. And your answer is not a trivial answer. I know that.
No. That I prayed even there. I remember there with my father. We managed to organize almost every day that we worked. A kind of minyan, a kind of quorum to say our prayers. One day, somebody sneaked in or smuggled in a pair of tefillin of phylacteries for I don't know how many portions of bread. And we stood in line, my father and I, we got up early, stood in line just to wear the tefillin and say our prayers. If I could pray there, does it mean that the prayers were received? Of course not, they were not. My father died.
We're here to talk about God. And I need to follow up what you just told me by saying, if God was not, you can't say it wasn't listening, but if God was not responding to the prayers of you and your father and the millions of others in the camps, if God was not moved to intervene at a time like that, how can we believe that God ever responds to a prayer of petition?
Not necessarily, no. Sometimes you pray not because of the result, but because of the prayer itself. Our prayers are very beautiful. I'll give you an example. And sometimes absurd, again. There in Auschwitz, I could say, let's say, the prayer in the morning, Ahava Rabba Aftanu, O God, you have loved us with great love. Come on. There, you loved us with great love. But we said it.
Why? Why did you say it? Did you say it because it was so much a part of your upbringing? Did you say it because you had been taught to say it from earliest childhood on? Did there never come in the camps, Ellie? I mean, you and I have talked about this many times before. Moments of doubt.
Doubt? No. Questions, yes.
What question?
Oh, I asked, where are you? Why don't you? And absolutely, sure. But no doubt. No doubt because alone I had the right to doubt and despair. But when I thought of those I come to be their descendant, my father and my grandfather and his grandfather and his grandfather, I had no right. Thinking of them, if I thought of myself, I give up. But when I thought of those that I belong to, I felt I cannot stop. I cannot be the one, the last in a chain, to stop praying. So it's not so much about God. It has to do really with myself and my relationship to my forefathers. God can take care of the world without me. I cannot.
But that's different, isn't it? I mean, that's the old word, tradition. The fact that your father lived by a certain ethical code, which was the same that your grandfather lived by,
absolutely,
your great-grandfather.
Sure.
And there is an enormous importance in that.
Mm-hmm.
But that importance continues, I mean, forgive me for saying it, whether or not God exists.
If somebody comes to me and says, look, I used to be a believer, and because of what happened, I stopped believing, I understand. But there are also those who come and say to me, I used to be a non-believer, and because of what happened, I am a believer. It's also logical. Whatever the choice is, it's your choice. If it's the choice of the person who determines his or her relationship to God. And I have no right to intervene there. Every person is alone with God. God is alone, and man is alone with God. That is prayer. The beauty in prayer is when you speak to God, it's only God and you. And the prayers are beautiful. I love prayers. Again, that if I could pray there, how could I not pray now? But what were the prayers? Ahaba rabba aftanu, God, you have loved us with great love. Come on. It's a joke. Joke in Auschwitz, ahaba rabba aftanu. But we said it. Because my father said it, and because my grandparents and theirs, I come from a line of long rabbis. So certainly, I cannot stop it. I don't want to be the last in that chain.
Would you be the last if you said, I believe in everything we have been and everything we have done? But after what happened at Buchenwald, after what happened at Auschwitz, yeah, I cannot believe that God intervenes in the affairs of men.
That there is a medieval story, a very beautiful story, in Spain, during the Inquisition, the expulsion, there was a family who escaped from Spain into Morocco. There was a man, his family, his children, his wife, in the desert. The son, hunger, disease. The mother died. So he dug a grave, buried her, and said Kaddish. His first child died, dug a grave, said Kaddish. His last child died. dug a grave, he turned to God, he said, God, I know you want to test me. And he said, Kaddish.
There are ample examples, particularly in Jewish tradition, of those who have argued with God.
So am I.
Challenged God.
I wrote about it. I wrote so much about God, even against God. He can take it. Certainly. Sure. You can take it, and I argue with God. Take it against. I have written so much. I'm surprised that he didn't stop my pen somewhere. Maybe he did.
And?
But from only always from within the tradition.
Always?
From within tradition, not from outside.
Is it possible to be a good Jew and not believe in God?
Yes. Who am I to say who's a good Jew? I don't know. If a good Jew, let's say, those who go to Israel, for instance, in the beginning, the Chatzim, they were not religious. But the bad Jews, okay. They left France and England and Romania and Hungary, and they went to Palestine. They were good Jews. Those who go to the army in Israel now and fight for Israel. And those who give their lives to work for the poor and for the hungry. Whether they believe in God or not, it's not my business. I am not here a judge. I'm a witness, not a judge. Who am I to judge anyone? I accept if a person does something for the other with grace, with honesty, with decency, without the faith to become fanatic, I'm with that and I'm for that.
Can we talk a little about the modern world, the world in which we live?
That's more difficult, but it's okay.
It is more difficult, and it's particularly, I have to tell you, I mean, Ellie and I are dear, dear friends. Once, many years ago, he did me the great favor of coming down to talk to our staff at Nightline, and I picked him up at the airport, and we went out to a hotel where the staff was gathered for a retreat. And on the way there, I needed gas. And I pulled the car into a gas station and pumped the gas. And when I got in the car, Ellie was looking at me with enormous admiration. And I said, what? And he said, you know how to do that. I said, what? He said, pump the gas.
Yeah. It's true, I don't.
Will Rogers had a wonderful line years ago, the great Oklahoma cowboy humorist. He said, you know, we're all ignorant just about different things. This man is totally ignorant about anything technological. However, that technology now, Ellie, as you know, has brought the world so close together. We have the capacity to communicate around the world in a split second. There is more information being transferred around the world at all times than ever before in the history of mankind. Are we moving in the right direction?
No, because information is information. It doesn't mean that it is knowledge. Between information and knowledge, there is a distance.
Big difference. Yeah. In a sense, many of the technological abilities that we have now, this ability to listen in on conversations, to know what people are saying in the most private moments, to be able to move almost at the speed, I mean, faster than the speed of sound, maybe one day even at the speed of light. All these capabilities that we have are what in a more primitive time would have been known as God-like abilities. Are we coming closer to God or further away?
The guy who went around the world, around the globe, for the first time, but he said, no, a Russian.
Yuri Gagarin.
Gagarin. He came back, yeah. And all he had to say, can you imagine, he said, went around the world, I didn't see God. Big deal. Really didn't see God. That's Russia. You know, and atheist was part of their religion. Yeah. You know, that's a religion, marvelous. The religion of atheism. Perfect. But look, to the believer, God is everywhere. To the non-believer, God is nowhere. Perfect. You think that I think of the non-believer that he is inferior? Of course not. It is my relationship to my fellow human being that determines my humanity. That's all. It's not with God. It's only the fanatic who says everything is related to God. No. It's what I think of you, what I do if somebody who in the street needs just a dollar.
Do you believe as literal what you read in the Bible?
I love the Bible. I love it. I love the Bible and the prophets. I study it all the time. I have written about it enough. Mm-hmm. Literal, is it literal? Was it meant to be literal? I don't think so, of course not. Everything is symbolic. And I am a student of mysticism, so everything is mystical. Which means it's literal, but in a strange way.
We have this great paradox in Judaism that we are not supposed to even imagine what God is.
How can we?
Well, we can try, but we will always fail, right? And we have to fail because there is no defining.
Because we don't know. Has anyone seen God or tell me what it looks like? Really. I don't see it. But there is something of the divinity in every human being, black or white, young or old, in everything. When we say man is in God's image, that's what it means. There is something of God everywhere. And therefore, when a person is being persecuted, actually, that persecution implies God. God, therefore, is, and it's my choice, either with the persecuted or with the persecutor. And I prefer to believe that God is with the persecuted.
But again, when you say that, Ali, you've lived it. This is not a theoretical exercise for you. And when you say God is with the persecuted, how does that manifest itself?
We can say, look, there is a saying, Imo Anochi Betzarah, from the Bible, God says, I am with you in distress. Which means when humanity suffers, God suffers with humanity. Now, some people therefore believe that God is also with those who persecute humanity. I cannot believe that God is with the persecutor. God is God and therefore is with the persecuted, with the victim.
Ellie, I've got to come back to my original question. The relationship with God to so many people is one of turning to God when you need sustenance, when you need support, when you need help, when you have a problem, when you face an obstacle, and turning to God and quite literally asking for help. Now, you very elegantly evaded my question when I asked you the first two or three times. But one of the reasons we remain friends is I never give up and you never answer me, right? Do you believe that there is any point in praying to God for a particular outcome.
If that's what the solicitor feels like doing, feels the need to do, let him do it. But it's not only that. You say, look, the first prayer of a religious Jew is a prayer of gratitude. It's called Mudeh Ani, I thank you, God, for waking up. Just like that, for opening my eyes. So it's a prayer of gratitude. Look, I open my eyes, I'm alive. And then we go on. Thank God for the bread that you give me to eat, for the fruit that I receive, for the friendship that we have. I thank God that for that too. Now, does it mean that I have no problems? Of course I have problems. I have written enough on that in my books. Against God. Against, yes. But that is the marvelous dimension of Jewish belief. We have the right to question God. There are two words for it in the Talmud. One is chutzpah, and the other one is trulia, which means ask questions, yes, chutzpah, no. Which means speak to God with chutzpah. It's not nice. Just like that, it's not nice. But with arguments, of course. There were masters, Hasidic masters, who were known for that, for their way of arguing with God. Just like that. They were great, religious, pious, mystical masters.
Let me suggest that maybe we make a mistake when we envision God as being all-powerful, omnipotent, that perhaps God's special relationship with man lies in the fact that he has made, or she has made, herself vulnerable and requires the assistance of mankind to be restored.
Possible. I'm not.
You and I once talked about it, and you told me that there actually is some belief. I mean, when you talk about the spark of divinity that is in each of us, right? What if God had smashed itself into an infinite number of pieces? And then each of us, when he or she is born, has that little spark of divinity. And what God needs to be restored is for us simply to love each other, is for us simply to be there for each other. And that would restore, God needs us rather than the other way around.
I go for that.
Well, you'll go with anything, right?
I mean, I go.
You accept
God,
that?
Absolutely. God needs, that God needs man. If you think about the value of the idea itself, of course, God doesn't need anyone. God is God. But I may say, because we have, in the mystical concept is God is not only God alone. There's something called the Shekhinah, which is a kind of mystical presence of God, almost. And we manage in mysticism to divide. God is God, but the Shekhinah espouses the human condition, which means wherever we are, the Shekhinah is with us, in exile. And therefore, our goal and our task is to restore the Shekhinah to its original throne next to God. And how do we do that? By being human and kind to each other. Not to them, but to each other. Which means the moment human beings are more human, the divinity of God is more exalted. You accept that?
We're not doing very well, are we?
We are doing very well.
Hmm?
We are doing very well.
You think we are?
I mean tonight.
No, not me. Not you and I. They'll be the judge of that. But I mean, the human race is not doing very well in terms of achieving.
Well. Hmm? The world is not doing well, believe in it. But when you think about the human condition today, it's despairing. Literally, it's despairing. I'm looking for places where there is hope, where there is, I mean, exalted hope. I don't see it.
Ellie, you've been studying all your life. You have been considering the human condition and man and woman's relationship to God. You're 85 years old now.
Right.
You feel any closer to a solution than you were 50 years ago?
No. Of course not. Well, that you know very well. The real questions remain unanswered, always. Meaning, the questions about humanity, about destiny, about God, about exile, about redemption, and in general, what do we do with our life if we cannot make it into a gift to each other? What are we doing? It could lead to despair. After all, we are all mortal, so why go on? Why have children in a world that is not very kind to children? Jews in a world that used to be very hostile to Jews and still is in many places. And yet, Jewish parents have children. Do you know that the Talmud tells us that in Egypt, actually the Jews were so desperate, they decided not to get married again, not to have children. As if to say to God, Mr. God, if that's what you want, okay. No children. But actually it's Moses' sister, Miriam. She is the one actually who managed to convince them, no, wait a second, you cannot live like that. The husband, go back to your wife. But the temptation was there. During the first exile, and even the second one, in Judea, it happened. The Pharisees comes from the word peroshim, the separate. And they actually left their wives not to have children. Then came the sages and decided, we cannot, hey. If everybody will do the same thing, there'll be no more Jewish people. And send them back to their wives. The wives were happy.
In the thousands of years now, 5,700 years plus, mm-hmm. that the Jewish religion has existed, have we moved even one inch closer to God?
Ask him. What do I know? I don't know. My question is not that. My question, have we moved closer to one another? That is the question.
All right. What's your answer?
Bit by bit. I do believe that it's possible for two human beings to become friends or to get married, have children. I do believe that this is possible. It is possible to vanquish destiny. And destiny is rather powerful, but nevertheless, it's possible to vanquish. And each time when a young boy falls in love with a young girl, it's a kind of slap in the face of destiny, saying, you don't want us to get married, we shall get married. Go to hell. Yes, it should be.
I don't like that answer. No, I don't like it, because...
Come on, it's an act of defiance.
I mean, that's been going on for thousands of years. What both of us, I know, find so frustrating is there really is no evidence that we are evolving ethically. Can you honestly say that you think the world is ethically a better place today than it was 100 years ago, or 500 years ago, or 1,000 years ago?
Yes and no, really, in truth. Yeah. Yes and no. Yes and no, because there have never been so many schools as there are now. There have never been as many philanthropic organizations as there are now. So, nevertheless, there is what we call in France une prise de conscience, a kind of an awareness of the other person's need. But you mean, during the Spanish Inquisition, it was better. Those times, when the pogroms in Russia, it was better. Today, we don't have the pogroms here and there, of course, and anti-Semitism exists, which is a shame to humanity, that anti-Semites can still be anti-Semites.
Yeah, but hey, we can't, you know, we can't measure the progress of civilization only by what's happened to Jews through the years.
No, you haven't.
I mean, you have been a leader in your time in standing up against some of the truly dreadful things that have happened in your lifetime and mine. What happened in Cambodia? What's happening in Congo? What's happened in the, you know, in Yugoslavia? Can we say that we're making progress as a species?
Species, no. But society, yes. There are more democracies today, after all. Maybe democracy is not absolute, but nevertheless, without it, you cannot go on. So I think, take any century that you take, the Inquisition century, or the Civil War, was it better then? No. Do we make progress? We make progress because we gave the democracy a meaning which transcends its own frontiers. We believe democracy is a goal, the goal of society. We cannot imagine a society without democracy. I cannot imagine living in a place which is not a democracy, of course not. But nevertheless, there are still millions, if not hundreds of millions, of people who live in places that are not democratic. So does it mean that the world has not improved? But nevertheless, I saw a film with Marian a few days ago about slavery. When I saw it, I couldn't believe it. In America, my country, which really, and I love this country. You know, I come here like you, I came as a refugee to America. And when I discovered there was slavery, almost in my own lifetime, slavery, the ultimate humiliation, the ultimate shame inflicted on the other, slavery, in this country. And when they show in the film the family that owns slaves, a very good family, nice family, a good father, a good husband. And it was here. No slavery today.
Oh, you are wrong.
Maybe.
Oh, you are Maybe. Wrong, Eli.
Maybe.
I fear that there are forms of slavery in this country today, not legal, but they exist. And the conditions of many of the workers who are here illegally in this country are as dreadful as, well, yes, there is still slavery.
In that case, we should fight it.
Hmm?
In that case, we should fight it.
Of course we should.
And organize ourselves better, more efficiently to fight it. Why don't we organize a conference against slavery? People will laugh at us. Slavery today? Come on, really. It's the 19th century. But I'm ready to do it. You tell me there is slavery, I'm ready to fight it.
We are almost at the point now. I don't know physically what happens. Do you come up here and give me some questions? Ah, look at that. Thank you. If you could, what question would you like to ask God, and what question might God ask you?
I don't know what he could ask me. I know what I would ask him. One word. Why? Why?
Well, since God can't ask you.
He can. Maybe he can. Do I hear him?
Ellie, it's what I was trying to get at from the very beginning. When you ask that question, why? I'm going to interpret. At least until you come in and tell me, no, Ted, that's not what I meant at all.
No, I meant it.
Why the pain? Why the suffering? Why the hatred? Why the inhumanity? Why the unfairness? Why? Mm-hmm. Why? And why, God, haven't you done anything about it?
Tell me, if there is hatred in the world, and there is hatred in the world, you want to tell me it's God behind that hatred that used to be? During the religious wars, of course. Although even then, I'm sure that I'm convinced all those who believe that they were fighting and killing in the name of God, they were actually insulting God. How do they know that God asked them to do what they were doing? God spoke to them, but never they invoked God with their, even with their flags. Now, one thing to me actually is clear, that whatever obligations I have towards God must have an interpretation, application to my relationship to my fellow human being. If I respect my fellow human being, then I speak about God. It's very simple. Look, it's written. Thou shalt love thy fellow human being. It's called Ve'ahavta l'rayacha kamocha in the Bible. You must love your fellow human being. And then comes the end. Ki ani yad Hashem, for I am the Lord. Hey, where's the connection? That is the connection. If I betray my fellow human being, I betray God.
Interesting question that flows out of that. You and I are now much closer to the end of our lives than we are to the beginning. What are you looking forward to? What are you expecting on the other side? Do you believe in a life after death?
Look, I come from a tradition that believes in life after death.
I'm not asking you about your... what do you believe?
I come from a tradition that... I don't know.
That's a cop-out.
No, it really is. What do I know?
Well, you can't know. I'm not asking you what do you know. Look. I'm asking you what do you believe. What is your instinct? What is, if you want... What is your hope?
Look, I believe that life does not end with death. Something is happening. Personally, for instance, I feel the presence of my father all the time, although I was there when he died. Nevertheless, I feel his presence. The same is, of course, with my mother and my little sister. I feel their presence. Does it mean that they really are? But I feel their presence. Which means the dead have their own presence. It's up for me to accept it, and I do. Does it mean that I believe in afterlife? Everything in me wants to believe in it. I hope there is, I don't know. You can be a good Jew and believe in it, and you can be a good Jew and not believe it. I can give you all the sources for that.
I wasn't asking you as a social scientist. Asking you just, you say you feel the presence of your mother, your sister, your father. They were a part of you while they were alive. It is natural that they would be a part of you after they are dead. But there is this, you know, many of us are raised with this sort of childlike belief that someday we will be reunited. It suggests that the personhood, the individuality that both draws us together and creates antagonisms here on Earth, that will exist in some form in the life hereafter. Do you believe that?
I want to believe that.
You want to?
Yeah.
You want that individuality to be replicated somewhere?
Yeah.
I'm tempted to say, for God's sakes, why?
Simply because I love them too much.
That's fine as far as it goes. Are the only people in the life hereafter then going to be the people you loved? Because there had to be others too.
I'm sure there are.
It just becomes sort of a continuation of this uncertain place that we have here.
Here we must go back to the sources. In the Bible, we don't speak about it. There is no afterlife in the Bible. The concept is being explored only later on in Talmudic commentaries, but not in the Bible. Moses died, he died.
You spoke of the difference of information and knowledge. How does one attain knowledge without having information as a part of knowledge?
Oh, it's part of it, yes, but not everything. Information it's in itself, without knowledge, it's only information. 2 times 2 is 4, it's okay, good, all right. It's information. But knowledge is more profound. It means the depth of the facts, that is the knowledge.
70 million Falun Gong practitioners are being persecuted by the Chinese Communist Party for their beliefs. How should Jewish people relate to the Chinese regime in this light? And I have to hand it to you, you don't throw easy questions up here, do you? Ellie, what do you know about Falun Gong?
What I read occasionally, but look. I am ready to take on China. I'm not sure. I'm ready. But the battle that we fight today against fanaticism, against dictatorship, still, against violence. We have so many battles. You mentioned Yugoslavia. Remember, I was there one day. I went to Yugoslavia for you, for Nightline.
I know.
You remember that?
Yeah.
Hey. I will never forget that experience, really. Because there, it was a civil war. Usually they believe that people kill each other because they don't know one another. There they knew one another. They were from the same family. Neighbors killed each other because they knew one another. And remember, I would ask them, why do you hate your neighbor? What do you mean he said? Because 432 years ago, his grandfather.
I have a question here to you, and I know the answer.
Answer it.
What brings you joy?
Oh, listen, I have joy. First of all, what brings me joy is our grandchildren. We have grandchildren, my wife and I. The love of our life is our grandchildren. I have a grandson. I cannot go on because it'll go on the whole evening.
No. You know why I want you to go on? Because so many people came to know you. I have a grandson sitting out in the audience here today, and his mother certainly believes in prayers of petition because he just turned 16 and so he has his driver's license. But he and his classmates, as he told you backstage, they've just been reading Night. And I want you to go on about your grandson a little, because where you were 70 years ago and the conditions that you faced and the tragedy that you saw, to see new life, an extension of your family, not just one generation now, but two, that must have very special meaning for you.
Of course it does. Naturally it does. Look, my adult life has been with young people. I've been teaching for more than 40 years. I love it. To live in a world of young, for and of young people, and try to give them everything that I have, that I am, so that they could do something with their lives. To be in a classroom is an extraordinary reward. To be able to give and receive. I had thousands of students in my life. And I must tell you, not one of them disappointed me. Not one. So therefore, look, I used to be a journalist like you, but you were not on the same level, you, of course. But nevertheless, I was a journalist, sure.
It's all right. I haven't done very well as a Nobel laureate either, so...
Ready to share it with you.
Ah, perfect. I am a teacher, and I teach Night to my eighth graders. At the end of our unit, I ask them to write about what they think is the most lasting theme from Night. What theme would you hope lives in them after they finish your memoir?
Commitment to memory. Just that, commitment to memory. What is Night? It's a memoir, memory. I am defined by my memory. My fear has always been, and what if my memory would be too small, too poor, to contain everything I want to give? That is the fear, really. But we are here in order to give to each other what we have, to leave something, a trace. I think it was actually Malraux, the great French writer, said once that his dream, he said, was his dream, as a young man, as a writer later on, he said, is to leave a scar on the surface of the earth. And I would like to leave a scar on the surface of history, of destiny. A scar, if not more than that. And every story opens a scar. But what do my stories say? They ask questions. How is it possible you speak about God? What about humanity? The killers were also human. Why believe in humanity then? The killers had college degrees. The killers had PhDs. To get a PhD in Germany in those times was not so easy. So this was possible for them to study and teach Kant and Hegel and Schiller in the morning, in the afternoon, go and kill Jews? How is it possible? I still don't understand it. So the questions that you ask about God, I have more questions about whatever is being done here.
All right, here's an easy one. Do you believe in intelligent life on other planets? And just to personalize it for you a little, Ellie, what if no one there is Jewish?
Impossible.
And the hard part, what if they can prove there is no God?
If they can prove it, let them come and give me the proof.
The New York Times came out with an article saying that 47% of non-Orthodox Jews are marrying outside their,
their faith.
Their faith, yes. Versus the 17% in 1970. So let me say that again. I saw the article. 47% of non-Orthodox Jews marrying outside their faith versus 17% in 1970. Why do you think this is happening? What has happened in the last 30 or 40 years for this drastic increase?
I don't know. I really don't know. Which means I don't want to say things that I have not really thought about in depth. And when I hear that, I didn't see the story, but when I hear that, it gives me really food for thought. I have to think about it.
Well, and as you know, I'm one of the 17%, and we did it 50 years ago.
I know.
So, you know, there is one here. I don't want you to think that, for Ted Koppel. Question. Did you really think you could ever get a straight answer to any question from Ellie? Now, you know the only person in this room arrogant enough and knowledgeable enough to ask that question. Her name is Marion Wiesel. How long have you two been married?
Very long.
A very long time.
she remained young, but very young.
Incidentally, speaking of a very long time, I'm going to do something that I know they don't like doing here, but these written questions, I love questions straight from the audience, don't you?
Sure.
Yeah. This man has been doing this now, coming here, giving lectures, for, what did we figure out, 47 years?
60. 60 years.
More than 60 years.
I think so, yeah.
But you've been doing 4 lectures a year here for at least 47 years.
Yeah.
So we're coming pretty close to 200 lectures. And you have the extraordinary privilege, if you raise your hand and I recognize you, of standing up, and I promise you the one thing I'm very good at is cutting speeches short. So ask a question, try and ask it quickly, try and ask it clearly enough so that we can hear you up here. You got a couple of hard of hearing old men up here. Who would like to, yes, go ahead, stand up please. Yes. Go ahead. No, that's easy. The answer is Marion Wiesel. Now, what?
About passion you heard, okay. About books, I read a lot of books, a lot. Mainly philosophy, it's my field. I love philosophy, theology, or the philosophy of literature. And sometimes if the period of the novels is good, and I read novels, there are not, I don't think that we have seen a great novel, a great Dostoevsky. We have not seen that for some time. So the novel as a literary genre is not doing too well. There are good novels, but not great novels. A novel that changes one's life when you read it. When I read Kafka, it changed my life.
What's the last great? Forget about great. You don't want to categorize any recent novels as great. What's the last really good novel that you enjoyed?
Oh, not the new ones, really. I go back to what happened. I went back to the Dostoevsky novels. I love the Dostoevsky novels.
You read new novels at all?
Yes. I don't want to give names because it would be an insult to those I don't name.
No, no.
But anyway, but I read novels, sure. I used to be a literary critic, believe it or not, for the New York Times.
Really?
Sure. I wrote a lot of reviews for the New York Times.
It's a very difficult thing to do, isn't it? I mean, it's difficult because you know as a writer yourself how much passion you've poured into that work. And to criticize something.
I have not done that.
Yeah, you were probably a kind critic, weren't you?
I don't think I've written negative reviews. I cannot hurt somebody, I just cannot. And the only thing I did at one point, the New York Times called me up to write a review on movies. Now, I am not a moviegoer, Marion is, she knows that, I don't. So it was a movie on the Holocaust. And it was horrible. I remember we had a private screening, Manny and I went to see it. And it was so bad that I called up the Times and said, I'm afraid I cannot do it because I don't have time. I didn't want to hurt the poor guy who did the movie or something.
Actually, what Ellie really wants to be is a sports columnist. That's the... All right, question. Yes, ma'am. Yes.
Job is a different. No, here on this stage, I have given lectures on Job for so many years. One of my favorite books, actually, because it's everything is in it. Job really is a book of questions. That's why I like it. It's a book of questions. At the very end, it actually ends with questions. And the moment God gives the answers sound not so good. But the questions are very powerful. The problem is, my dear good friend, that you know me well enough, I love questions. I don't like answers. So you put me in a position that asks me questions. I love questions. All my life is questions. There is quest in questions, and therefore I love it. The quest for meaning, the quest for connection, the quest for eternity almost, the question. The questions are eternal. The questions remain, there are very few basic questions. Answers come and go in the hundreds. Every social philosophy is full of answers. All are wrong. But questions remain. I am determined by my questions, not by my answers. And here, who is my great friend? And you force me to give you answers. In truth, we didn't discuss our coming here. Simply we had an idea to come and be together. My concept of it was on the contrary, that it should be a real conversation, not questions and answers, but a real conversation of two friends. We meet, whenever we meet, it's always an event for us. And do something with it. Questions, well, I don't know the answers. Believe me, I don't know the answers. The basic answers, the real answers, the existential answers, I don't know. Why are we here? Do I know? I mean, not here in general. Why are we here in this world? What are we doing? Why are we here?
You really know how to set up the next question, don't you? Question. Yes, straight back. Go ahead.
Well, it was... I remember we were in bed, man and I, and then on 4:30 in the morning, the doorman called. He said, I don't know what's happening, but there are a lot of journalists downstairs. And we were in pyjamas. We had heard already rumors, but on Yom Kippur, it happened really on Yom Kippur, I fast Yom Kippur, synagogue all day. And usually between one service and the other, I come home to rest a little bit for a half hour. So that afternoon I came home, and downstairs there was a man. He said, he wants to speak to me. I said, who are you? He said, I'm a journalist for the Swedish paper. I said, sir, this is Yom Kippur, holiest day of the year. Please, this is not for journalism. Not today. He said, I must speak to you. I said, please. And I went up, and he forced himself into the apartment. As we came to the apartment, he had, behind his back, he had a bouquet of flowers. And he gives the flowers to my wife, to Marion. I said, what is it? He said, because I am a journalist for the Dagens Nyheter, and wanted to know the headline tomorrow is that you received the Nobel Prize. I said, sir, really? It's Yom Kippur, don't you? Not now. I said, please, not now. And I went back to the synagogue to do my prayers, fasting and davening. And then, and then it happened.
So the answer is, your first reaction was, not now?
Not now. I said, don't talk to me now about it. Yeah. Also, I didn't believe it.
Really?
I didn't believe it. So I really felt, come on, Yom Kippur, it's a very special day, for us. We fast and we pray. Very special prayers, very beautiful prayers. And he comes to talk to me about something which I didn't believe in. I didn't think it could happen.
Let me ask a follow-up question, though. How has winning the Nobel Peace Prize changed your life?
It didn't change me. It didn't change my life.
I know it didn't change you, but how did it change your life?
Oh, simply it changed because I'm busier than before. That's all. It didn't... More journalists call for interviews and all these kind of things, but basically it didn't change my life. More things to do, you know.
We've got time for two more questions. Yes.
Hi. I've been curious for about 20 years.
How old were you then?
I was like 11 or 12 when you called out Bill Clinton on the 100th day of bombing in Sarajevo at the Holocaust Museum. I just have always been very curious as to what his response to you was. Has that made you my social hero forever?
Well, thank you. No, he did. We spoke. We spoke right away. He said, I promise you I will do something. Absolutely. Immediately. Clinton is a good man. Immediately said, I promise you I'll do something. But then he said, okay, the same scene, he said, are you ready to go there? I said, oh, yes. And I went as his emissary. I was a presidential envoy. And I went there. So Clinton, he listened right away. And he did immediately.
Last question. Let's go to the very back. Go ahead. You're the one I was pointing to.
You know, Prophet Elijah.
The question was, when was the last time you bumped into the Prophet Elijah?
Prophet Elijah, we are told, is never the same. He never wears the same clothes. He does never have the same face. That is unknown and intentionally so. That whenever I meet someone, I should ask myself, maybe that person is Prophet Elijah. Therefore, be careful.
Well, that's not a bad note on which to end.
Okay.